What's going on, everybody? It's your girl, Sammy Joe the Fox, and you are listening to the Homegirl Fox podcast. I'm here with my special guest, man, and you know what? I was going to, like, lay everything out that you fucking do, but you just do too much, girl. Gina View's in the building. We got to give you a round of applause. You do the most. You're doing the most right now. We got West Coast Confidential. Professionals, my personal fave. You doing your own ciphers. What's that called?
The ciphers, that's the first thing I ever started is DX.
Oh, for real?
Yeah.
Damn. Okay, and I was going to actually already ask you that. But let's get into like a little personal stuff real quick. Where'd you grow up?
L.A.
L.A.? All over L.A.? South Central. There it is.
Washington on Western and 108th and Western.
Okay. And what was that like? What was like the young life for you?
Interesting. It's in the hood.
Yeah. Of course. Yeah.
I was in like leadership, student body council.
Okay.
I'm sorry, senior class council. I was the senior class historian. I edited my senior year yearbook.
Okay.
Plan prom, plan homecoming.
You're a planner, you're a creator.
Yeah.
All together.
I was a newspaper editor. Yeah, pretty much. I was like, you know, involved.
Yeah.
Our cheerleading team was whack, so I had to get in somewhere else.
Or else it would have been that.
I really did want to be a cheerleader.
That was like, bring it on.
Yeah, hell yeah. I thought that's what high school was all about. So I did cheer Pop Warner for Snoop's league.
Oh, okay. For sure.
So I knew like, okay, boom, I'm gonna go to high school.
Yeah.
All pom poms, yeah. And skirts and football games. Hell no.
You was out of that. Yeah. But it sounds like you got like, you kind of started off early doing like the low key skills that would help you today.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Did you know that this is what you're going to do?
No, pretty much what I would say is that, like now with me doing the ciphers, the same thing, then I just wanted to kind of be in charge of the moment.
Okay.
I wanted to be responsible for the moments that our senior class had.
Yeah, the same planning.
Exactly.
So I got you.
I wanted people to remember me for, you know, that's the girl who created the theme for our yearbook.
Yeah.
That's the girl who, this is the reason why we went to prom at this location.
Yeah.
This is, you know.
It's basically throwing parties.
Hell yeah.
You know, that's what it is. Like, people try to figure out, like, I used to throw parties in high school, outside of school, mm-hmm. like, for money.
Mm-hmm.
But that was my thing. It was like, I could get a bunch of people together.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Influence.
Influence. Mm-hmm. Influence. I never knew I was going to, it was something I wanted to do. I didn't even have like the confidence of doing it though. I was like, mm-hmm. that's never going to happen. I don't know how my life was going to end up, to be
right,
real with
right.
you. But this was the way that we went. It seems like right. we're microphone girls.
Uh-huh.
We talk to people. We can put our social life to work in any aspect around anybody. You have that, like, yeah. big time.
I didn't even know, though, like, to be honest with you, after high school, my plans was to be a RN.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But you were, like, trying to make money, though, RN? Or you were yeah, like, I want to help people, RN?
Well, no. Everybody on, like, my father's side of the family,
okay.
all the women are nurses.
Oh, okay. So you're following
some
steps.
My dad works in mental health. So
oh, wow.
It was pretty much, like, this is what's already set out for you. This is you're going to go to this school, you're going to be an RN.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to go do your GE, get your GE classes, but then when you're going to transfer, you're going to be an RN. You're going to start off as a CNA.
That's nice. Teacher,
one of the teachers at Washington asked me, like, well, what are your plans, you know, after high school? And he was actually the radio. We had like a radio after school program.
Okay.
I wasn't in it, but that's what basically, like, you know, what he did on campus or whatever.
Yeah.
And he asked me, you know, like, well, what are you going to do? And I was like, I'm going to nursing school. And he said, the hell, you supposed to be on TV.
Wow.
So you have the voice. You have that personality, that charisma.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, nah, because it's like, I'm from the hood, you know?
Okay.
So there's nobody from the hood that's like me that I, like, look up to, who I can, like, identify with as far as, like, examples, I would say.
You mean, like, in the radio scene? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. No, oh, that's for sure.
There's nobody, like, you know, there's rappers, there's athletes, there's
sure.
all these type of people in those professions. But as far as, like, there's nobody who I look up to, like, oh, I grew up watching you and we can identify with each other because we're from the same area.
Got you.
You get what I'm saying?
I get that. Yeah.
It's people like Angela Yee and stuff like that, mm-hmm. but she from the
yeah,
East Coast.
For sure.
So I didn't even know that like it was something I always wanted to do because I like grew up like standing in front of the TV introducing the videos before.
Oh yeah, hell yeah, like
Park,
DJs.
Know? Hell yeah,
that's exactly what I wanted to do.
If I was watching like Yo MTV, I mean not Yo MTV, what was it? MTV Jams.
Yeah.
Like, and I knew the video that I was about to come on because of the commercial that just went off or prom that just went off. Like I would introduce the video.
Yep. Okay.
So that was like always my dream, but then at the same time like. I just didn't even see that for myself. Like
I get you.
My graduation was shot up. It was police at the graduation. Yeah. The week that she went on lockdown, you know?
Like, yeah.
So I didn't even know that somebody like from the hood and from where I come from can even be doing what the fuck I'm doing right now.
That's crazy because you said that your dad works in mental health, right? Mm-hmm. You must have grew up a lot different, like being fed like some good things because he knows like mentally what can keep somebody strong.
You would think that.
Yeah, probably work a lot.
you would think my dad did work a lot. I was not raised with my mom. My granny raised me for the majority of my life. My dad eventually took over during like high school years. But for the most part, like I done went through shit that you wouldn't even believe, that you wouldn't even be like, how the fuck is she still standing here strong? And like, dang. You know, like if I tell people my life story, they're going to be like, this sound like some shit straight out of a book.
Well, shit. Okay. I mean, what you planning on that?
I'm planning on writing a book.
You have to.
Yeah.
You have to. There's a story behind everybody, which is why I like doing this stuff. Especially you. I was like, I could get you on my other show where we play music and we get to know your personality. Mm-hmm. But I personally, like, I saw you on Mad Lately with Vic. Mm-hmm. And Vic's the homie. Shout out to Vic. And I instantly found love with your personality. Aww. I'm serious, girl. Like, I felt instantly, I was like, how come this girl is not on the radio? Like, since I was little, I wanted to do MTV Jams too. I wanted to be Bill Bellamy.
Right.
I wanted to have fun and just chill with the artists. I don't want to be so serious. I just wanted for you to see that side, with their chill side. You know what I mean? And then growing up listening to Big Boy, I was super into the radio because my mom likes radio personalities. Mm-hmm. So even growing up, I even thought like, dang, if I could put my own radio station together, I'd put this personality and that, you know?
Yeah.
I hear somebody's voice, I'd be like, yo, you got a dope voice, blah, blah, blah. And some people, I'd be like, mm-mm, they don't belong here. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But when I heard you on Mad Lately, I followed you instantly. I was like, dude, this girl's crazy. Like, you would be so good on the radio.
Thank you.
Have you ever tried out for radio?
No, I honestly don't have any like urge to even want to do the radio anymore. But initially, like when I would, cause I would looked up like the host on 106 in Park.
Okay.
Just to see what was their journey.
Yeah.
Like, what did they do? Did they go to college? You know, like what actually did they go through to get to?
What is it anyway?
They all did radio.
So is it broadcasting or like they had went to broadcasting school? Or they just did radio?
I want to say the majority of them, they did. It was like communications, but they also did like acting because they were still entertainers.
For sure.
But for at least, I want to say Free and Terrence and Roxy, I believe they started off in like at radio stations in New York. But, you know, it's bigger out there. We probably have like what, three stations?
Yeah.
Maybe four.
Oh yeah.
Out there, you know, they have like way more. So I think the opportunity itself is like bigger, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
But that's what the hell they did. They was on the radio. So I said, damn. So I'm gonna go to school, major in communications, do radio, get in at the local radio station.
Start from the bottom. Yep.
Or whatever. But once I found out that like what radio really is, and it's like what I wanted to do was more so like podcasting.
For sure.
But podcasting wasn't a thing
yet
4 or 5 years ago.
Crazy.
You know?
Yeah.
So now it's like, you know, you can talk and all of that. But once I found out that I wouldn't even be talking that much on radio, that I'm just basically following
you're just like
guidelines and stuff.
It's even worse for the female.
Exactly.
It's super worse for the female. I went in there and I was like, you know, they wanted me to read reports and do certain things. I'm like, and you know what? I could barely read. What are you talking? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I could talk to people all day. I could do this. I could do that. I know my music and stuff. But nah, like, that ain't me. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And I was like, oh, like, they look for a part. You know, it's a little storyline. It's a show. It's my wife and kids. It's, you know, it's the older brother, the middle sister, and the baby.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? And I was like, okay. And to me, like, it broke my heart. I went into the radio stations. I went into two of them. Well, three of them. I went to three of them. Mm-hmm. and God redirected me for some reason. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad podcasting came out. But years ago, I was doing like streaming. Mm-hmm. And like now it's popping.
Yeah.
But like 7 years ago when we started it, it wasn't popping.
It wasn't popping, yeah.
It wasn't popping. That's so like I already tried this.
With the innovation of like technology, we can do this shit on our own. So you don't even need a big, because that's all radio is a freaking network.
For sure.
It's just an organization. It's a company. And you have to follow those guidelines. And
yeah.
You feel me? So now that we're able, like our era is able to create this shit and do it on our own. Yep. And put it out on our own. And we have all of this access and resources and stuff. Yep. Like I still, you know, still want to do radio one day.
Yeah, you have, like, girl, you have to do radio, Gina.
I feel like
it's
I'm
crazy.
Just too, I would want to be the dude on, I forget his name, but he have a real like cool voice. He come on 94.7, I think.
94?
It's like, so he got like a smooth voice.
He's like the old school Theo?
He's an older guy. Hmm. Like, I think maybe when I'm old, like.
Yeah, well, see, that's honestly like my plan. I've like planned to, well, I'm going to start this new radio station that's local. It's a Boyle Heights radio station, and it's just in a couple inner cities.
Yeah.
And I want to take that to like Sirius XM because I would love to do Sirius XM later. Mm-hmm. Right now, you're right. We have like the ability to create our own, do our own. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I had a head start when I first started it because I used to work for B-Roll TV.
Okay.
And so we had our own show, and it was, you know, me, my homegirl, she was a DJ, and we talked to artists, and we did so many things that I felt were like super... I was like, shit, we opening the doors for many people. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't seen back then. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It was like, oh, no, y'all doing like something no one's going to watch type mm-hmm. of deal. And now that we have it like this, like shit's popping. I look at over there at the screen. I'm like, all right, we good. We got our own show going on, yeah, you know? Yeah. But then I see you, right? And I see you do whole fashionals. You guys, whole fashionals is like that. I want to see that shit like after like... 2 episodes of Catfish. I just want to, yeah. Like, at 11 o'clock, like, that's the slot for professionals. Uh-huh. We need to make that happen. Like, if I was white, I would start, like, a petition. I mean, you got to be white to start a petition and really make it happen, I think. But, for real, like, what's the plan for professionals?
Right now, I'm looking for an animator.
So okay.
I want to turn it into a cartoon.
Wow.
I think that'll just be really dope. Like just hearing my voice under
Fucking brilliant.
Cartoon and
hilarious.
Just looks like me and all
dude.
That. I think it would be really, really great. But like you said, right after like Catfish or something, because I could see it on like Adult Swim.
Oh yeah.
You know? Like I think
Adult Swim
fire.
For sure. Uh-huh. Oh, for sure.
But yeah, it's literally like right now with whole fashions, it's just me. Like it's no team. It's just me, my iPhone.
Yep.
And the people who submit stories.
I need to know how you started whole fashionals.
Okay, so what's so funny about that is so I went and met with this guy and he contacted me and he like sold me this whole like dream how, you know, I'm going to make you a star.
Okay.
You know, like it's the whites.
Okay.
I'm going to make you a star. You're great. You're beautiful. Da, 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 da. But he liked, when he saw me, he liked, how ghetto I was on GXPO TV, on the Cyphers. So I'm just the homegirl and stuff
okay.
like that. But when I showed up in person,
mm-hmm.
I'm corporate. Like,
yeah.
I'm wearing, because I was, you know, I was told it was an interview.
Yeah.
So, you know, I have on my heels, I have on slacks, a button up shirt. And all.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
hi.
Yeah.
Hi. Nice to meet you. My name's Regina.
You put your Trader Joe voice on.
So
I feel you.
He's like, who is this and who is this?
Damn.
That's how, you know, kind of got at me or whatever. So,
yeah.
He pretty much asked me, like, what was my goal and what I wanted to do. So I told him, like, I want to be on red carpets. I want to do things like that. I want to be at the BET Awards. I want to be at the Hip Hop Awards and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I want to go to, you know, all of these different places and be able to represent my people or whatever. He's like, well, there's not enough. He said, so I showed him like a reel of GXPO TV. So pretty much at this time, I had only did probably like 5, maybe 4 cyphers.
Okay.
And
when did you start the cyphers?
What, like 2014?
Damn.
Yeah.
Ahead, girl. Good for you.
Thank you. So yeah, at that time I had a lot of content, but I didn't have a lot of content that showcased my personality.
Okay.
So
makes sense.
As he was looking at it, he said, "You know what? The show's cool. It's dope. However, nobody cares about these damn black guys." that you're interviewing. Don't nobody care about them. These just some little ghetto black dudes from the hood. They don't care about them. You're the star here.
Yeah.
And he went down my Instagram and he would compare the post that where I would post like pictures of me, like selfies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then he would compare that to me posting like artist music and things like that. So he had just told me like, this is the music industry. We don't care about these little black dudes, these little gangsters you covering, yada, yada, yada. Really like tore me the fuck down.
For sure.
So
I had a white guy do that shit to me at the radio station.
Yeah, it's the whites.
Yeah.
So he pretty much just like broke me the fuck down, made me feel like everything that I've done was bullshit. Like bullshit. I've been following these artists and doing all this stuff for nothing. Yeah. They don't even have record deals. They're not this. They're not verified, you know? And trashed I have to let them know like, no, nigga, like this is who I believe in. This is my city. You feel me?
Like, he was stomping on like not only something that you created, but something that you take so much pride in because it's where you're from.
Exactly.
I get you.
Exactly. And I never.
That's what they do because they just don't like they don't know.
Right.
Like y'all have like just cheese and little dinner parties, but like we're like the real thing. Like it's culture and it makes you feel some type of way. Mm-hmm. You watch, you know, like we watch a lot of things happen. I watch friends change up. Whether it be good or bad, like hella bad, but it means a lot. Yeah. It means a lot to me too.
Mm-hmm. So he was just like, you need to put your, cause I've never like been a type that want to make the shit about me.
Okay.
And that was pretty much what he was saying. Like, we can't see your personality on what you're showing me. Like,
okay.
You need to come up with something where you can see a personality. Mm. Whatever. All of that happened. And then the nigga said, so it's going to cost this much for me to get you on a red carpet. And then, that's how pretty much that whole conversation summed up. And then, you know what? This is what he said all of this shit threw me off, but he had said some shit like, how old are you? So I told him how old I was and he was like, oh, I guess it's true what they say, black don't crack. So this is a white telling me black don't crack. You feel me?
Yeah.
But
they always say the wrong shit.
The wrong shit. Then he invited me to come out to a party with him that night. So it was just like all horrible. Like it was just a really bad experience. But I took from that experience, although it was so fucking horrible, what I took from that experience is that you're 100% right. You don't see my personality.
Yeah.
And you feel me?
It's sometimes in those little shady moments that you have to see that like some part of that is truth. Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah,
you don't. So I had even went through all the episodes. I'm like, damn. The cipher is, it's an 8-minute cipher. You see me for 7 seconds.
Wow.
You know, I'm coming up and saying, it's your girl, Gina Views. Welcome to the
Introducing like you wanted.
And I walk off. Yeah. You know? Even with the interviews, I'm asking a question. You do interviews, you know.
Yeah.
You ask a question, you let the guests express themselves.
For sure. So you don't That's
see,
what it's about.
Exactly. You don't really see my personality. Mm-hmm. But on my Instagram, you know, I got selfies and stuff like that. So I was like, well, what the hell can I do in the meantime that's cost effective?
For sure.
You know, because the cyphers, I'm spending like 3 to 5 bands filming them. You know, the same thing like with the interviews, it's a couple of hundreds.
Yeah.
And I'm a full-time student at this time. I'm probably working at Walmart. Mm-hmm. I had 2 jobs, Walmart and Ross. So it was I didn't even really have the funds to continue to just dish this dough out like that.
Got you.
But so I was like, well, what the hell can I do that I don't have to pay for? Like, what can I do? So I'm the friend that the homegirls call like, bitch, this dude just did da 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 da. Bitch, I was with
the home. That's the homegirl right there.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's why I call this shit this.
So one of my friends, she had like every day she had call me with like a new nigga, like new situation, new dude, new whatever. She had have stories from way back. So I asked her like, how you feel about me? Before that even happened, freaking Surviving R. Kelly came out.
Okay, I remember
and
that.
And I remember the girls just sitting there telling their stories and their experiences with him. And this is around the same time that, you know, I'm trying to figure out
what you're going to do.
So I said, well, damn, what if people come on my show and tell me
their shit,
their experience and stuff like that? So I was like, I got to be realistic. Bitch is not about to sit up on camera and really.
It's hard. You know what? You know? Sometimes they do, but you're right.
Incriminate
themselves. Yeah, yeah.
So I was like, well, I can just take the same angle that Cheryl Strawberry does on
102.3. That's
where
right.
They send her the letter in.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my homegirls, like I said, she would tell me her stories all the time. So I said, how you feel about writing out what you said to me, changing some things up so it's not, you know,
for you to display to you, it. Yeah, you know?
It's not traced back to you and I can share a story. Like, what you think about that? She said, let's do it.
Smart.
So she sent me probably about 3 stories, and then from there they just start fucking coming in. Like, so many people want to express themselves and tell, you know, what their experiences are. And it's so good, because even like what I take from it is when they send any stories in, like, they see the lesson in what they did.
Oh yeah. When you hear it out loud.
Better. Exactly. Mm-hmm. How they could have did better, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So my whole goal with it was like, let me tell these stories. But like, I took sex education classes in college.
Okay.
So
I'm damn, like, you even, well, okay, you equipped.
Yeah.
Cause like, you're not only just the homegirl on the level to be able to talk like that, but you can also break it down.
Exactly.
Woo.
So fire. I know, like, even like what I would be talking to one of my friends, and she would say like, girl, I did da da da, the nigga burnt me, or I did da-da-da-da. Now I got a funny smell. It's like,
and you could, bitch, do the whole shit.
You were supposed to pee after you had sex, bitch. You need to get tested between parties.
Dang.
Did, you know,
so you're a real hoe professional.
Damn.
You so are
able to like just kind of find a, like, yeah, it's comical, it's entertaining, stuff like that, but I also have to make it educational as well. Like, let's find a lesson in this, because we can't just be out here fucking up and doing bad.
This is why I like doing this shit, for real. Like, right. from the moment that you even said like all your jobs and stuff like that, I like that we can break it down away from all the things that you do to say like, this is where you came from,
right?
And then in this place to be like, professionals is not just like get on the mic and say whatever. Like, she knows what the fuck she's talking about.
Cause that's what a lot of like people, like, I done had dudes say shit like, oh, you just sitting there in your panties. You just, I mean, you doing that. It's called whole fashion, dog. When, like,
certain guy, yo, like, you know what? You know, I'm just gonna say the word predator men. Predator men, when they see like something sexual, that's the only thing they see. Like, right. They didn't hear what you said. They didn't realize how educational it was. They didn't realize the story. They just saw panties. That's the
panties is just clickbait. Y'all gonna click it?
Hell yeah.
You feel me? But
if she knows what she's talking about in the panties, that's a double right there.
Exactly.
Come on. Exactly. I mean, that one's just like, when I went from watching Mad Lately to Hofessionals, yeah, you're right, actually. It definitely displays a total different side of you. Mm-hmm. It's more intimate. Mm-hmm. It's you do feel very homegirl already when you start watching it. Mad Lately, though, I'm like, she's at the table with 2 boys, and you know, it's a male dominated industry.
Hell yeah.
And it's really I'm not gonna say it's hard, because some guys really like pull up for us. Mm-hmm. But it also could be very, very difficult to be like the only chick around and like have to keep up with that, unless you're a real one and you can do it.
Right.
And you did that shit.
Thank you.
Like, you, I love Vic, and I'm now like seeing Gabe, and I'll mm-hmm. support him too. We haven't met yet, mm-hmm. but you really did outshine. And I really saw that for you. I was like, dang, like she could handle it all. She could have handled that by herself. Like, this girl really, you really know how to, mm-hmm. to speak. You know how to talk, you know your music.
Thank
so
you.
I want to know, getting into that though, you knowing your music, like, where does that come from? You just always been like into it?
Like I said, as a kid, like 106 and Park is my dream job.
Yeah. So you pay close attention to that. Is it that 106 and Park inspired you so much that that's why you wanted to do that stuff? Because you're a rap commentator. Like, so I'm like, you must know theory. Like, you must be that involved in it.
I'm not even into music, like, down to a science type.
Okay.
It's just that, like, growing up, like, my daddy just used to listen to freaking N.W.A.
West Side
Connection.
For sure.
Tupac, Snoop, you know, like, all the greats and stuff like that. So the same thing with my big sister. Like, Tupac was her favorite rapper.
We always get one up, but we got a big sis.
Yeah.
Big brother, big sis. Like,
and like, I'm the youngest of 5, you
yes.
know. All of my cousins are older than me and stuff like that, so I'm always like, you know, the baby. But even like, I didn't even notice how much of an influence that they had on me growing up, because it was just regular to me. Like,
yeah,
rap music and the culture was just like fucking water.
Of course.
You know, it was,
but
just
when you're the
regular
baby, you're getting that stuff injected into you at different ages. Like, that's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, right, 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 right.
For
right.
real.
But yeah, pretty much I would say like all of that goes to my big sister, rest in peace, and my dad. Like, okay. They just really just put me onto the music, and I honestly think it was unintentional. Like,
yeah,
I'm just looking up to them and wanting to listen to what the hell they listening to.
Yeah. Once God put that in your ear. Yeah. It is what it is.
But once I discovered, like, Metaphors and shit like that blew me away. Like,
yeah.
One of my favorite rappers, well, my favorite rapper before everybody is Fabulous.
Okay.
And it was the No Competition.
Yep.
Series, the Soul Tape series and stuff like
that's
that.
That's because you're a writer.
Yeah.
That's what that is.
I would literally listen and be like, you know what? Initially, I didn't even know how to break these lyrics down. So
okay.
My best friend, Dejanay, her big sister name is Tiani. Tiani, we was driving one day, we was listening to Pussy Money Week.
For sure.
Her boyfriend at the time was a battle rapper.
Okay.
So I'm sure he probably pretty much like introduced her to, you know.
Yeah, everything she knows. Whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So she was breaking down Pussy Money Weed to us.
Yeah.
And I didn't even like realize like what he was saying, you know, until she broke it down. Like, it just tripped me the fuck out that somebody's mind can even go that far. So then getting into Lil Wayne, and it's like, he's taking these people beats. And he's hearing a whole nother flow
with
than
the
what was
tapes?
Initially, yeah, than what was like
man.
Initially presented. And that shit just like, that's why I said I'm not into it to like a science. I'm just into it as far as like,
it's infatuating.
How did you come up with that?
It's so smart. Like, it's great. You know what? During those mixtapes and during Pussy Money Weed and all that, like, I was just becoming like a heavy stoner. So I was like, I was smoking and then like just totally into my mind and then the music, and I'd be like, I mean, stoned out, mind blown though. Like, yo, like what made him like, cause he has the smallest, craziest little metaphor rhymes all stacked into one song, and he keeps it going. Mm-hmm. He just keeps it going. It don't even have to really match up. Like, Lil Wayne is probably the most impactful when it comes to that. Mm-hmm. I feel like Lil Wayne's number one on that end, because everyone else, they're just, I mean, they go through everything a full sentence, like they go through full rhyme, you know what I mean? But Lil Wayne has that. That's why they say that joke, Lil Wayne rap, tap my uncle on the shoulder, call it Tapatio. Have you ever heard that? Like, dude, it's true, but yeah. It's fire. Yeah. It's fire, like all in one. Man, those are good times right there for the mixtapes from Lil Wayne. Mm-hmm. Lil Wayne's one of the GOATs. Who's your favorite right now?
Current, like I said, Fabulous is my like
all time,
but currently, like Reason.
Oh, Reason's hard.
I was a part of his journey. And
okay,
he was a part of mine. So
he do one of your ciphers.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
who some people that like really flew up from your ciphers?
Reason, Bino's done a cipher.
Wow.
Rucci done a cipher.
Oh, they're all cracking right now, and you too. Look at that full circle moment.
Hell yeah,
that's beautiful.
A lot of people like I was their first interviews and stuff like that. Like
wow,
just because, but they was like my early, you know.
Hell yeah, I get it. Get that.
We all pretty much like I would say like came up together. Reason gave me the dough to throw my first actual like concert or whatever.
You guys threw a concert?
Yeah, so it was called Thankful for Hip Hop, and
dope.
We did it after Thanksgiving but right before Christmas.
Okay.
So we had like
nice.
A big ass Christmas tree, but the you had to donate a toy to get in or whatever.
Dope.
And Rucci performed, Sean Mack, rest in peace, he performed.
Oh wow.
Reason, Trev Deshawn, Ash Bash.
So these fools all got your back because you had back day one.
Yeah.
I know
the
feeling. It's a good feeling though.
Yeah.
It's the day ones, it's you can't forget that.
Especially, and they all are like well aware that like G-Expo TV was created during a time where niggas wasn't like all of this fake unity shit that's out now and everybody so want to push the culture forward. Like that shit didn't exist before. It was no platforms for up and coming artists like that. You had to either be, the label had to be looking at you already, or you had to already be a part of the label.
Wow.
Like it was not a platform for people who were still fucking making music in their homies' garages, you know?
Damn, like, yeah.
And that was my whole thing, that I wanted to get them from the nitty gritty ground up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Are you like, still, are you, because I was thinking about it too, because I seen you like kind of, I feel like when you did Mad Lately, you stepped away from your cyphers a little bit.
I completely stepped away from the cyphers and Ho Fashion.
Yeah, but it's understandable. You were also working a job at the time, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and I also followed that, and I did want to talk about that a little bit. Mm-hmm. I know you just left your job maybe, what, a couple months ago?
August. July 31st, actually.
July, okay. Mm-hmm. I know this feeling because I did it myself, but I want to hear your background on this, like where you were working, what you were doing, and why you left.
So I worked in corporate America. I worked for a company who manages the mobile devices for other big organizations.
Okay.
So if your job gives you a company phone, mm-hmm. and give you a computer, laptop, I was basically the feds.
Gotcha.
Monitoring your usage, looking at what you're doing, and I'm reporting it to your boss. Hey, this person is texting this much. This person sent 17,000 text messages. Find out if this is work related. That was my job. Like super duper techie.
You were the feds.
I was with them for about 5 years.
Okay. Wow.
They were good because it was actually. It wasn't too flexible until quarantine happened, mm-hmm. but I was still able to do my thing. I was making enough money and I was able to go to school.
Yeah.
So it was cool, but I found myself like being stressed the fuck out every day, just coming to the realization that I'm putting in 8 hours a day for somebody else's dreams. Like, this not what the fuck I want to do. Like, I'm spending all of, like, as a creator, that shit is frustrating when you really think about it. Then, you know, you get stressed out every day. It's like, I'm so fucking stressed out at this job that mm-hmm. is not going to do anything in my future.
You're replaceable.
Exactly.
And you feel that the whole way through.
Hell yeah.
Because even when you do a good job at like any corporate, they still got something for your ass so you don't get a raise. You know what I mean? There's something. Mm-hmm. You clocked in like 2 minutes late. Mm-hmm. So, like, really? I'm here every fucking week. I do the fucking most. I'm out here cleaning the toilets. And you guys aren't going to give me my raise because I was 2 minutes late?
Right.
Like, it just sounds like a fucking setup for disaster right there.
But I took I was just so damn stressed out one day. So I took a vacation. I planned for a vacation. And,
okay.
It was a week vacation. I told myself, while I'm on vacation, like, my goal is to find something that's going to be paying me and is going to replace
working on your day off.
9 to 5. Yeah. And within that vacation, Blueface hired me.
Okay.
As his assistant. Also within that, you know, I did apply for social media at No Jumper around that time. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It was earlier in the year I applied for it, but I didn't know that I was going to get it until like the day before I got the interviews. Like,
oh, okay.
I didn't even know that they even seen my resume.
Oh, I see.
Because it says Regina.
But you went in like trying to be in being social media like management, and then they like just got you.
No. Literally, like I said, I was looking for something.
Yeah,
I was
yeah.
going to replace, you know, my 9 to 5.
Your other job, yeah.
The Blueface thing happened. I ended up seeing that I enjoy rapper hours. Mm-hmm. I enjoy not having to get up at 6 a.m. I enjoy being out until 6 a.m.
Amen. That's why we started the show so late.
Yeah, waking up at noon.
For sure.
You know, like, I realized that I enjoyed that. I loved the atmosphere Blueface had me around.
If I could have been a DJ, that was the only reason why. Yeah. Like, my DJ homies, I'd be like, so, like, they'd be like, you know, come out with us, blah, blah. I'd always be in the booth, you know, enjoying everything that you get in the booth. Mm-hmm. And then they'd be like, you gotta go work tomorrow. Like, you gotta wake up at what time? Yeah. Like, why?
And I'm the friend who can't go anywhere because I'm on a set schedule. Like, I was always.
I believe
friend.
That
I
shit.
I never was like going out of town and stuff.
I risk it all.
Vic actually saw the ad on LinkedIn.
Oh, okay.
Social media position at No Jumper. So
okay.
Vic ended up seeing it. So I told him, I'm like, well, send it to me then, nigga. Like, so he sent it to me and I applied, but it was just something that like just left. I never followed up or anything like that, you know? But like going in and stuff, I'm like, well, shit, if I'm looking for something that's going to replace my 9 to 5, let the team at No Jumper know, like, hey, I'm here. Like, I know how to edit videos. I know how to use, you know, Canva. I know how to do graphics and shit like that. I'm a fucking computer. I'm very, very, you know, tech savvy.
Nice.
Like, you know, just, you know, let me know if it's something available or whatever. And I end up telling them, like, did y'all see my resume? Like, I ain't seen nobody else in here. I ain't seen y'all hire or whatever. So they had, like, you know, talked internally, and I end up getting a phone call, like, all right, you got an interview.
Okay.
With four of us. We're not going to treat you like you the homegirl, and we already know you.
I was going to say, you wear the corporate suit or not?
Nah, I didn't.
I mean, Adam's white.
So what's so funny is I had ironed my little uniform shirt, and then I had just got off work, actually, from my regular job.
Okay.
I hurried up, clocked into the Zoom, whatever, but I had to go get my hair done.
Okay.
So I had the camera, like, position, like, just for you to see, like, hair and the shirt.
You learn from them quarantine times.
Girl, got on there. Adam said, you can turn your camera off.
I like that.
But they had me so nervous. They, like, you have to go through two interviews.
Yeah.
You're going to interview with all four of us. Like, it's four people at the office or whatever. And, like, they didn't talk to me, like, on no, like, call me shit. Like,
no.
Like, we know you already. It was like, all right, so why do you think you know, deserve this position? Like, they asked me to interview questions. So I was in that motherfucker sweating bullets, not knowing, you know, but they ended up giving me the job. So shout out to Adam and Josh for they the reason
hooking
why I was
you
able
up
to quit my corporate job and shit. Now I'm stress free. I ain't.
And you went straight to being you for real. Well, good for you, girl. I know the feeling. So you went straight from like what your resume said. You went straight from that to doing Mad Lately.
Yeah. So Mad Lately was actually Vic's show.
Okay.
So
he came up with that whole thing?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's the name of his magazine for the Rosecrans magazine is called Mad Lately.
Oh, okay. I didn't even know that.
Uh-huh. So that's Vic's show. So just so happened when Adam told AD, I'm going to give you a show. You can pick whoever you want your co-host to be.
Oh, AD.
Me and Adam had already met, I want to say, the month before when did COVID start? 2020?
February, 2020, something? March.
So we met in February.
Okay.
So I was already supposed to come on there as a media broadcaster, as one of the co-hosts, whatever. COVID happened. Everything shut down.
Mm-hmm.
We just didn't talk about it again. Fast forward to it was probably like October, November.
Okay.
Eddie called me like, hey, Adam about to give me a show. You know, he said I could pick whoever I want. I want you to be my co-host. Within that same breath, Vic called me.
Yeah.
He said, hey.
Oh, I do remember this.
Yeah. He said, hey, Adam offered me a show. I wouldn't want nobody else except for you.
Wow.
So I told him, like, well, AD just offered me to be his co-host too, whatever. So he like, oh dang, I wish I would have got to you first, whatever.
Yeah.
So I'm like, nah, I do both. Like, I'm trying to be
yeah, why not?
I said I'm trying to quit my job.
Hello.
Like, you feel God. Me?
Yeah, why not?
So fast forward, they ended up deciding to go with because there was a social media manager at No
there
Jumper
already.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they wanted her to, you know, do some more on camera stuff.
Okay.
So they ended up making her AD's co-host, and then
I see.
I went with Vic or whatever.
Yeah. Well, it was good with Vic.
Hell yeah. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I think that was the right touch.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, AD's a great personality.
Yeah.
I actually interviewed like 80 years ago, on B-Roll TV.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
I had interviewed a lot of people before they shot up and did certain things.
Right,
but
right.
AD was funny as hell.
Mm-hmm.
And he's killing it.
Mm-hmm.
He honestly shocked the shit out of me because
you
just don't know whose personalities until they actually talk.
Yeah. He's a great media personality.
Yeah.
He's great to see. He's great on screen.
For sure. Mm-hmm. But so that didn't end up happening with AD though.
Yeah. End up doing Mad Lately.
Yeah. And you felt like a comfortable spot there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it was a good fit.
Mm-hmm.
Like you three just kind of like, it just felt very like home-like. Like it just felt very home. I felt like my homies were on. Like that's the feel I like.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? When I can watch something and it take off like that. But then it came to an end.
Yes.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
It sucked because like I was watching it and I have certain people, you know, people talk. It is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, they're not getting a lot of views. And I'm like, it just don't make sense though. Cause it's good.
Mm-hmm.
It's good, but it's one of those things like it's fucked up in our thing. It's like people are so focused on the views and this and that, but like even for me, if anyone says anything about my views, I'm like, I'm not worried about that.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm worried about content.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It'll be what it's gonna be, but I thought it was really great content.
Yeah.
And I'm sad. I hope you guys come back.
Yeah, no, we're still working on taking it to somewhere else.
Okay.
Because at the end of the day, I don't think that our vibe and our content was for No Jumper. Like,
oh, okay.
I don't think that we...
That was not the fit there.
Yeah, I don't think it was the fit there. However, it's great. But like you said, when people be talking about, oh, the views and this and stuff like that, but...
Yeah.
you get those people who talk so much about what is wrong and they're not even fucking supporting.
Oh,
you get what I'm saying?
100%.
So you get people that's like, they'll talk all this shit about, we don't see enough brown, black and brown on
I'm
TV
over that
and stuff
shit.
Like that. We don't see enough this, we don't see enough that. But we not seeing it because y'all not helping the people who's doing it.
100.
So people be complaining like, oh, why the Breakfast Club won't interview me? Oh, why this, why that? But why are you not supporting your local media personalities and helping them push up? Because they'll... Yep. It's niggas that'll do the interview, but they ain't gonna post it.
For sure.
You know, they'll pull up the interview,
are
but
you
they
kidding?
Gonna post it.
For sure.
But they'll go with the whites or somebody that's viral, and they gonna post that. But then I just seen so many people talk so much shit about Adam. So much shit about
Adam. I bet. Yeah.
And
I've heard
at
it.
At the end of the day, can't nobody knock what he doing.
He's like, doing it.
And I done seen people talk so much shit, but they'll come to us and do an interview. Mm-hmm. They'll go to Adam and do the interview.
Yeah.
You know which one they gonna post?
Yeah.
The Adams. One with Adam.
For sure.
You feel me? Like,
yeah. I know it. I see it all the time. It's a shady game. You just got to focus on what you're doing.
Exactly.
You know, and if you believe in what you're doing, then that's the secret sauce right
that's
there.
That's all that matters.
That's really the secret sauce that works. One thing that is working for me is West Coast Confidential.
Oh, yeah.
Man. That's what I'm saying. Like, Gina, just watching you, like, I get happy for you.
Yeah.
Because you're a personality that shines, and I feel like you, without even knowing your background like that, I'm like, I could just feel how deserving you are.
Thank you.
And I feel like that show, it's DJ Crystal, right?
Yes, Crystal the DJ.
Crystal the DJ, excuse me. I'm surrounded by a bunch of Crystal DJs, by the way. So everybody...
Don't mess up Crystal.
Yeah,
man.
Trust. I got a Crystal Alice. I used to kick with Crystal Iris, and now we got Crystal the DJ. Yeah, but anyways, Homegirl's dope too.
Yeah.
You guys have a great vibe together. Mm-hmm. Want to talk a little bit about that show?
Yeah, so Salas, that's all Salas.
I love Salas.
He pretty much just put out there, like, I think Crystal and Gina, you guys make sense together. Y'all should come up with something.
He's smart.
Right. And I told him, like, well, me and Chris went to high school together. Like, we was in leadership together. She was I was a senior class historian, she was a senior class president.
Shit.
So we had
it's
already
a match.
Like exactly. We both from the hood. We both went to Washington and stuff like that. So pretty much it like that was all Salas. I had already wanted a countdown show.
Okay.
I said, 106 The Park is
you can feel the inspiration behind you for sure. Real.
But one day Salas just said, "Hey, let's do it." We did it.
He's
we
so
talked
smart.
About different like concepts and stuff like that, show titles or whatever. What will we put out, what type of, message we wanted to send. And I didn't even realize until, like, they said it, that there's no hip-hop shows with two black females.
Oh, yeah. There's not even a radio show.
Yeah. It's
We're
either,
in L.A.
It's either a female, two guys, or, a guy and a girl. Like, there's no, like, female-dominant show, hip-hop show, especially black females.
For sure.
And
not at all.
I didn't even realize when like me and Hale was on live one day and he like, well, how do you feel about it? And I'm the kind of person like I don't even realize stuff until I go back and you feel me, like
it's not your focus.
I try not to get too like excited about what's going on because I know that life happens and anything can be snatched at
100.
Any fucking given moment. You're not old shit. So like when it's happening, I'm just living for the fucking
the moment.
Look at the step in front of me. You feel
same.
Me? And
it gets to that point, know, if you faced rejection along with rewards, like you just know, like the rewards usually like they're steady. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's that other shit, the rejection shit that like it'll really fuck you up.
Right.
So it's better to just stay balanced in the middle, ready to work.
But he had like brought to my attention, like you making history right now.
Oh yeah,
and
both of you.
I'm like, well, you know what you did.
You got to give yourself that credit. Give yourself that flowers. It's because when you have tunnel vision, you're a creative mind. So you're not even thinking, like you said earlier, when you talked about that other story, like when you started the ciphers, you weren't thinking about you. You were like, yeah, I want to do this, but it's a short part of you. And the rest is all like the talent.
Uh-huh.
You know, you wanted to showcase people, and that's what you're still doing.
Mm-hmm.
You're really, really good at it. I just love that show. I want more people to see it. I'm like, people are catching on though. It's starting to get all them retweets, and I see it. Like the likes
it's
are coming
episode
in.
Episode 6. So
We got a long move to
just
go.
Just dropped today. Go click the link in my bio.
Yeah, man. You guys got to check that out. West Coast Confidential. And Hofessionals is coming to an Illustrator near you. Let me see. I have some other stuff I wanted to ask you just on some motivational stuff, because obviously you're a hard worker and there's a reason where you're getting to where you're at. It's usually mentality wise, right? Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask you, what valuable lessons have you used since day one?
Just keep going. Don't stop. Like I said, I had my job. I was working in corporate and I realized at a point I was like I woke up, I clocked in, a client called me and was hot. The bitch was mad mm-hmm. about something that I didn't even do. And you know, it's not your mistake, but it's your problem. You feel me? I'm a manager. So, and I had just realized like, God did not fucking make me to be regular. Like mm-hmm. at the end of the day, God did not make me to be regular. So I tell myself every day when I wake up, like it's on my phone. The first thing I see on my screen is make today count. So just keep fucking going. Like you are in charge of the outcome.
100.
Like, no matter, you can't blame nobody for anything for not sure. going the way it's supposed to be. Like you are 100% in charge of the outcome. Like that's pretty much it.
A lot of people focus on being slept on. Have you ever felt that? Like you were thinking people just were sleeping on you at a moment?
Yes. There was a time where I felt like I was slept on and I felt like it was certain people. Like before I had a relationship with Head, I wanted Head to see me so bad. Like,
oh shit. Yeah.
Like, look at me. It's big Head, bro. Head. Head, I'm right here. Look at me. Chuck, look at me. Head. You know, like you so stupid. Fucking bad. Like even
that's who I started with. Head.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I did B-Real TV. Uh-huh. He was the DJ. He was the DJ and Tattoo was the main attraction. They brought me Little Hood Rat in mm-hmm. and I was just like there to kick it.
Yeah.
They're like, you want to jump on the mic? And I'm like, cool, let's go. Yeah. And ever since then, it's just been a ride.
Yeah.
But I was fortunate to cross mm-hmm. paths with Head at an early time.
Oh, I wanted them niggas to know me so yeah. bad. Head, hey.
Are you getting the FaceTimes and all that?
Hell yeah, that's my niggas. Same thing with like Karen Civil. Like now okay. she follows me and stuff
that's
like
what's
that.
Up.
She's somebody I've been like looking up to and inspired by for fucking years. Like yeah. I don't know what she do, but whatever she do, I want
to
do it.
You know what? Speaking of like getting to those big names and stuff like that, like when I seen Hofessionals, I was like, this needs like Issa Rae attention.
I actually, that's somebody else who I just feel like me and Issa Rae is the same person. We're going to cross paths at a point, but
I think we all feel that way because she finally brought real life to the screen.
She's the homegirl. Like, and that was my thing with,
survive.
You feel me? Like even me being a media personality, I'm not going to get up. I was so upset. I watched, I interviewed Rucci in 2015, I think it was.
Okay.
And I went back and watched the episode and I was so upset at how proper I was talking. It pissed me the fuck off. You know, like just watching. I'm like,
you were trying to do the job.
So Rucci, who's your top five inspirations and why do you think like, bitch, that shit is not fucking, that's not reality. You know, like
You gotta go through those though. It's that shit that it makes you so powerful now.
Yeah.
This is your time. You know what'd be fucked up is if it was your time then and you were acting like that.
Exactly.
Divine timing, girl.
I don't wanna be like, I'm so comfortable with my fucking beanies and my hats to the back and my big ass bamboos.
Be yourself.
Exactly.
Being yourself.
But you couldn't tell me that. Back then, like then I had to be like politically correct. I had to pronunciate every single word and talk like I do have a degree. I got degrees. But I have to talk like I have a degree. And it's like that shit not realistic. I'm uncomfortable doing it, you know. But
nah. That's what I miss. That is exactly what I miss about old school radio. So that was my thing when I ever wanted to do radio back then, when Baker Boy, when they were doing that back then, they were like themselves.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's no shade to like my radio friends, but it's very, very scriptive now.
Hell yeah.
And then not that you guys are even reading the script. It's just the fact that it's too perfect for me.
Yeah.
It's too perfect. We didn't live that life like growing up listening to the radio.
Yeah.
You could call in and be your ghettoest self, represent your high school. They put you on the phone. They talk, they might make fun of you a little bit, but these days it's just like, a little laughter at the end and intro laughter on the song.
Yeah.
Outro laughter too. Like, yeah. Y'all just happy in there? Like, yeah. Is this real or not? Like, what's so funny? Like, right. Y'all could have said the joke on air. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, what is everybody like always laughing and introducing shit? It just seems real unrealistic.
It
you know
is
what I mean?
Unrealistic.
Yeah. But no, we live in the time now where we could just do this shit. We could talk, say what. That's why I started a podcast because I was like, I just need the homegirl feel. Mm-hmm. I need people to know that when you come in here, you're just sitting with the homegirl Fox. It ain't a big deal. Just like my other show. My other show, it's called Play and Pause. And I just play I actually sit with the artists and play their music. Mm-hmm. And I only pick the songs I like. And I'm very like, I'm a lot like Head because I've been
transparent.
Yes, I'm super transparent, but I've been, you know, I've looked up to Head since I've gotten to the game because he's been a big homie to be like, mm-hmm. You could do this, but you're bullshitting. He's told me the truth.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And
Head's gonna tell you.
Head's gonna
Every
tell
time
you.
Every time he call me, I say, what I'll do? I have to go down my Twitter, make sure I ain't tweet no bullshit. Make sure I ain't posting it. But
yo,
that's why
that's
I fuck
funny.
With like both Head and Salas, cause they let me know. Like they gave me their honest opinion on whole fashions. Like, you know what? I think you might tarnish your brand a little early. You might want to do this, think about some rebranding and stuff like that. And me and Salas, I had a conversation. I let them know, like, yeah, you know, like it's more watch an episode.
Yeah.
You know, like, don't just look at that 15-second clickbait that I use to grab everybody in. And
yeah.
Once he realized, you know, and like, because
if you're comfortable, I think if you're comfortable, you're good.
Yeah.
You're golden.
They never was on no shit like, stop doing it. It was like, if that's what you want to do, we're just going to figure out how to work around it. Mm-hmm. You know, like, we're going to figure out how to don't. And Salas had a very, very big brand contacted me.
Okay.
They wanted to give me a show. And it probably would have been the one that would have just, you know, took me, you know.
Damn.
So they said.
You should pal them or what?
I didn't like the vibe I was getting. Like, I'm a vibe catcher.
I got you.
They let me know that their headquarters are in the UK.
Okay.
And whatever I've done, they're going to find out. So the guy who was over the show, the producer, he said, look, I met somebody on the set of Sweet Life, Issa Rae show.
Okay, yeah.
So she plugged me in with this guy. So it's people that's hella fucking connected. He's one of the producers on Basketball Wives.
Okay.
LA. So it's somebody who's really like, you know,
they got
there.
They're in the bag.
So this probably would have been it, you know, but he said, whatever you've done, they're going to look it up. They're going to Google you. They're going to look it up. They're going to do the investigation. They're going to find out if you have a boyfriend who's ever hit you before. If you have anybody that's in the NFL and they got cases, if you have this, whatever you've done, we search your name and it's tied to that. They might not fuck with it. So tell me everything. So I said, okay, I work in No Jumper. Mm-hmm. He said, is that the guy, Adam, with the prostitutes? So I had to break down to him, no, nigga, Adam is way more than whatever the hell you're talking about.
Yeah, it's funny. That's the first thing.
No, but that was the first thing he said.
Yeah.
So I had to let him know, no, this is who Adam is. This is what he's done.
Yeah.
And then he's like, well, what shows have you done? So I told him all my shows, let him know about Whole Fashions.
Okay.
He said, ooh. So after the conversation
I don't even understand,
it was so damn crazy, but after the conversation when I called Salas, let Salas know, and Salas was like, you know what, this could have been an opportunity, but go where you're celebrated.
Amen.
So I took that because I'm like, I was kind of a little like, damn, like this probably would have been, you know, it. But I already did Whole Fashions. It's already, you can Google it. It ain't going nowhere. It's on the internet. I'm going to stick to what I did and I'm going to fucking stand on it. If people don't fuck with it, they don't fuck with it. So I appreciate Head and Salas so much because they was never like, stop doing it. We don't fuck with it. You know.
Oh yeah.
We don't like it. They're able to see that there's a separation between that. Like that person is like a whole character. This
For
is
sure.
24/7. You feel me?
I feel you. And this is what made you who you are right now. Like,
exactly.
And you might not even think it's it yet.
Mm-hmm.
But you know how many people want to be in your spot.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, there's so many people want to be in your spot. Like. I know people who work their ass off and really try their best and do whatever they can while, you know, while still working the job because they can't leave yet and whatnot.
Right.
And they would kill to be in a position that you're in, because I think even myself, I look at you, I'm like, you're it. Even if you're even if you don't think you're really there yet, mm-hmm. the things that you are doing are so authentic and so like real life. Like it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen. It might have just been one of those things. Like you got to touch a little bit of it. You just got to like get a little taste of it just to know that like where you belong and where you don't belong.
Right.
You know, even if the bag comes with it.
Yeah.
I feel like the higher you get, the more you're going to be tested. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And people can't wait to like hit the bag and yeah. you know what I mean? And just get that over with. Mm-hmm. But you end up losing like all that realness mm-hmm. to so many things. So it might've just been like a fate thing.
I've accepted
that next big one's coming.
Yeah, I've accepted whatever is meant to be. Like God's going to give it to me. That's why Amen. I'm saying I only worry about the step in front of me. When you I'm not telling nobody out there to not plan and strategically figure out your next move or whatever.
Yeah.
But no matter how much you fucking plan and how much you put into stuff, whatever is meant for you is going to fucking happen because it's destined. Granted, you have to put in the work and stuff like that.
I was going to say
you
that.
You have to put in the work. You got to get dirty.
Yep.
But like at the end of the day, if it's not meant for you, it don't matter how much fucking work you put in, it won't happen.
It's true.
And whatever is meant for you, God's going to put that battery in your back.
Yep.
Give you that edge to make you want to go get it. But like that's why I literally only worry about the step in front of me, because the entire 2019 I stressed myself the fuck out. I cried watching the fucking Hip Hop Awards because I ain't there yet. Like I said, it was people who I wanted to see me who couldn't see me.
Yeah.
And I didn't even realize, like, bitch, you ain't even put in enough work for them to even know who you are.
Accountability, you know? Right there.
Yeah, like, why do you deserve to be having conversations with DJ Head? Why do you deserve for fucking Karen Silver to know who you are and stuff
for
like
sure.
that? Like, why do you deserve that? You ain't did
well,
shit.
Well, shit, that's just, that. Well, there you go. You could see how hard you work, because that was just 2019.
Girl, period.
For real, for real.
For revolt, and now the cipher.
That's right.
Revolt, you know?
That's like, right. And you can't, like, I tell people this all the time, like, pray all you want, but if you do not do the work, it will not come. Mm-mm. That's why I just say focus on the work. Too many people are worried about who's sleeping on them.
Yeah.
They're worried about how many views they got. Like, yeah. Don't sleep on yourself. Like, that's the key. Don't sleep on yourself, you know.
Don't nobody owe you shit. A lot of people,
entitlement.
A lot of people think that they're owed support. Like the reason why I put out so much content and stuff like that is because it was the content that I wanted to see. I'm not putting out content that I just think, oh, people gonna love. Granted, when I drop it, niggas fuck with it,
right?
But this is what I wanted to see.
For
this
sure.
Is what you feel me? This is what
you want to see it, but you know. You know there's an audience if you're that person.
Hell yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's the way to go about it. And like we said from the very beginning, you can just make these things now if you really wanted to.
Yeah.
You know?
I'm so invested into like, it was like even when I first started GXO TV, like mm-hmm. granted, like I said, I wanted to do a show that was similar to 106 in Park.
Yeah.
But it was more so like I had so many homies and stuff who did music that I felt like needed more. They needed to get more, get highlighted.
For sure.
They didn't have that. So
yeah.
For me, it was like, no, I want to put out this content because I believe in this. So I think other people should as well.
They will.
Granted, y'all don't owe these motherfuckers nothing.
No.
But here's some good content for you to fuck with. Here you go.
But you know what? You know what I think changed the game, though? This pandemic.
Hell yeah.
The pandemic changed the whole game. Mm-hmm. Like, I just do not, I act totally different from what I did before that.
Yeah.
And one thing is like right now you're doing the ciphers, right? Like this was a time when we all had to sit down, you know what I mean? Stay home. And all you can do is do content.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So everyone had to sit down and really listen.
Mm-hmm.
But now you just know how much time you invest in so many other things than actually doing that part. Mm-hmm. Cause so many people want to do this. You know, when people I get like want to be my co-host and then I bring them in here, like they be on one show, don't promote.
Yeah.
Don't get, you know what I mean? Like they just don't do the things that comes with this.
People think having a conversation is so easy.
They don't realize the energy.
Yeah, you gotta have skills to talk, to communicate. So they have a whole major in the college for communication.
They just think they're so funny to themselves.
Yeah,
like maybe in your head, but right. Damn, you really gotta do this. Like you really gotta keep a conversation going. But everybody can't wait to sit in the seat and just like be there in the shot
mm-hmm.
rather than do something in the shot.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like it's just not made for you.
Right.
I'm sure you get plenty of rappers hitting you up.
Yeah.
For the ciphers. with like little work? What is it that you look for when you like right now, if there's anybody in the chat, like, or just that's going to hear this podcast period that wants to like reach out to you and become part of your ciphers, what are you looking for?
As far as the cipher goes, I just want niggas to rap. Like,
you don't rap. Care.
Yeah. Just rap.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know what I'm looking for until I see it.
I got you.
Like, until it's right there in front of me and I'm watching it and I feel something, it's like, dang, this person's actually fucking talented. But like, I'm not sitting there going through, listening to a whole bunch of niggas' music and yeah. stuff like that. Like, I get hella DMs. Oh, tell me what you think and stuff. Dang. I'm not clicking it. Shit. I'm not listening to it. That's just the fucking reality.
It must feel so fucking weird, like, from when you started to now. Because I can't even imagine, like, people be hitting you up. They want to be seen. They're like, Gina Views being seen.
Yeah.
This is how I will get seen.
It's even down to the point where, like, people who I used to, like, reach out to for interviews.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, like, ignoring me and big
oh,
and
shit.
Like, they tapping in now.
Of course.
Yeah, like, oh, you want no jumper?
I hate
oh,
y'all. Yeah. I hate y'all too, by so, the way.
I don't
it's
even,
annoying.
It's so fucking sad.
Yeah, they don't know that people don't know behind the game. Like the, she like, I'm glad too. I had Salas in here a little while back and, you know, he really let me know big time when it comes to egos. Like I was missing that word because like, I don't feel like I have a big ego. Like you have to have an ego in certain rooms to do certain things. Mm-hmm. Like I can't go, you know, just do interviews with a bunch of big celebrities and not have some type of ego
mm-hmm.
because if you don't have that ego, you won't fit in with them mm-hmm. and they won't, they'll know.
Yeah.
They can see it. They can read it.
Yeah.
You got to be a star.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But I never realized that with rejection and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's all ego. It's coming from both sides. Me, it's like, damn, like y'all don't even see me as shit. That's why you're not replying, or that's yeah. why you don't want to fuck with me, or that's why you don't follow back. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But then there comes that other side too, where like we have like massive gatekeepers in LA.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Where they just don't want anybody. Someone knocking at your door? Is that you?
I don't even know who this is.
Is that the ring going off? Okay. Okay. Anyway, so gatekeepers, what you feel about like the people that are blocking blessings out here and doing stuff like that?
Fuck them. Shit, that's it.
I mean, shit, it just kind of goes in. I feel like every like karma's a bitch.
Yeah, I don't think I've even dealt with. I feel like for the most part, because I kind of got to a point where I stopped reaching out to people.
I'm done. That's yeah. why I'm also done with, like, earlier you mentioned it, and I forgot because we kept on talking, but that whole unity thing and, like especially for my culture, I'm done with the Latinos on sport, Latino talk.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm sure, like, I haven't even gotten hate or anything yet, but I know it's waiting for my ass.
Hell
you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah.
But I'm just done doing all that shit. Like, it's corny now to me.
Yeah.
Because people talk more than they do.
Right.
You know, we got a bunch of Latinos now for us on our side, which I really envy about the black community. You guys really do stick together. You guys really do.
But you know,
it's crazy.
You know, the black community says the opposite.
About.
And they think that that all the Latinos stick together.
Oh, shit. No. Nah, they got it wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
Trust. We were raised by envious tias and theos and oh god.
Yeah.
it's a wrap on that. Well, because like even when I first started the podcast, like that was one of the things I wanted to do because we aren't really displayed like that. Mm-hmm. We got rate people on the radio. Yeah, they're all fucking Latino. But what do they talk about? Nothing.
Yeah.
So you don't hear our stories. Right. You don't hear any of our shit, right? So this was one of those places where I was like, oh, this is to be heard, right? Mm-hmm. So like for sure I was like Latinos. But you start to see other people say that and not do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when it becomes tired.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, bro, like I'm not doing that shit no more.
Yeah.
It is what it is. Like, y'all go get your story here somewhere.
For the most part, what I would say, like, I haven't had like an experience where that I know of that mm-hmm. anybody was like blocking
blessings on you. Yeah.
But what I would say is like 2021, there were men who kind of stood up for me and was like, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to put you in this position. And that's that.
You for sure have that going on right now.
Yeah. So like starting with somebody like Adam, like mm-hmm. Adam could have went and got anybody who's already verified with a bunch of followers and stuff like that. But
yeah,
because of Adam and Josh, the whole No Jumper team, like I was able to fucking quit my job. Like yep. something I've been trying to do for so fucking long. Like,
for sure.
They did that for me, you know,
they know fucking, it works.
Exactly. Freaking, Blueface did not know me from a can of paint.
Wow.
We didn't know who I was. We didn't know, you know, he didn't know yeah. nothing about me. We literally met at his video shoot. His role manager walked me up to him. I was not about to go up to him.
Yeah.
You met, you know, I came, he,
yeah,
the
you
manager
didn't go bug.
Invited me. He like, you met Blue yet? And I'm like, nah, he like, well, come on. And I'm like, mm-hmm. nah, the nigga filming. Like, he's like, man, yeah. come on. He walked me in the scene as they, you know, yeah. as they go and introduce me to him. Later on, we end up talking. He had walked up to me, Gabe, and Vic, and was like, what's up with the podcast? So we like, you seen Matt Lately before? You know, like, I know y'all.
Yeah,
you know,
tripping,
y'all
huh?
And I asked him, like, well, what's up with season two of the show? Like, what, you yeah. know, what you doing or whatever? He said, you know, we need somebody to do the confessionals. So, you know, you can do it. Once he seen how much that I, because I'm like, oh, do you got this? Did you do this? Did you got this?
Yeah.
You got this stuff that didn't have to even do with that portion of the show, the confessionals.
Yeah.
He like, I feel like you need another, you know, I need to give you something else. Like, you need to be my assistant. You getting
nice.
All this shit done. You
hell yeah.
But Blueface gave me an opportunity. He didn't have to fucking do that. Like, yeah. he didn't know shit about me. Fucking Salas and Head. Granted, I'm from LA. They from the West Coast, too. They've been seeing me moving and stuff in the city. But
yep.
it took them to call me one day and say, hey, we feel like you out here alone. Mm-hmm. You don't got nobody supporting you. You ain't got nobody
for sure.
backing you. Like,
yeah.
we gonna add you in our circle of fucking love. Like, you know,
me and Salas talked about this. We yeah. talked about it on my show. And I got into it on purpose, but I got into it on purpose to, promo your show. Okay. And I didn't even see when he brought in his whole conversation about, male privilege. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Some of the best, like, real shit I had ever heard.
That's what it took this year. Like I said about worrying about, oh, and then fucking Nicholas Stokes. That's who got me on Revolt.
Oh,
another
wow.
man, you know, yeah. like, and it just took me to have them, all these male cosigns, because like people's like, oh damn, shit, she working with Adam. Oh shit, she working with Blueface. Oh, Salas and Head fucking with her. Oh
yeah.
shit, she on Revolt, you know?
And now here okay. So look at, see? See, and now, and here comes that, like I was talking about Latinos supporting Latinos and all that shit. But then here comes the women supporting women.
Yeah.
On that fake women. Yo, let me tell you something. People should not charge you for that shit. Like I see, whoa, women supporting women. Let me show you blah, 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 blah. But you have to pay this much to get this free game. Like,
girl,
no.
$500 for your brunch. Girl, fuck your eggs and bacon.
To Zoom? To Zoom?
Yeah. For you? No, no.
That's so silly.
I know too, like, and like I said, again, I have not experienced it yet
yeah.
with women older, like I'm not older, like at a higher level than me.
Uh-huh.
But like with females, probably like of the same, like, you know, we currently, you know, at the same, we might be like the same level right
peers,
now.
No, yeah.
Peers, yeah.
Uh-huh.
I've noticed like they would think like I'm trying to be in competition with them, or working with me is like it'll dim their light. And it's like, I want to fucking work with everybody.
Yeah.
As many shoulders as I can rub. Like, I yeah. want to work with everybody. I don't want to have no fucking enemies in the
yeah.
industry. I don't want to beef with nobody. I don't want to
yeah.
experience that at all.
See, but when you see somebody like, that's how I know too. Like, I'm not competing with you, right? So like, mm-hmm. I have that thing where I'm like, hell yeah, like I want to do this with you,
yeah,
right? But if I didn't feel, if I felt competitive, mm-hmm. I would be like, oh, she's intimidating.
Exactly.
That's yeah. like calling yourself out. You
yeah.
know what I mean? Like, if homegirl feels intimidating to you,
yeah,
why is it intimidation?
Yeah,
like people are so powerful together.
If everybody's end goal is one and the same, then you wouldn't even see that. You get me? Like, that's
facts,
what I said. Like,
facts.
In the beginning, like when I first started, it was never about me. It was always about the artist. G-Expo TV stands for Gene Exposure. It was
that's
always
right.
about the artist and me putting my homies on and giving them a platform to rap, because
yep.
it wasn't no, you know? And if I'm focused on boosting myself and me being the cute bitch in the camera and all of that, then yeah, I'm gonna look at you as competition, because your makeup done, you look good and shit like that.
Yeah.
Bitch, worry about the artist. Bitch, it ain't about me and you.
For real.
How are we competing with each other? Like, if the end goal is to put your city on and to do for your city and the artists in it, then it should never be about, oh, we competitive. We competing against each other.
Pure intentions will always win.
Bitch,
I don't care
that you look good and we, you feel me? No.
It won't matter.
I had situations where when I like first started the cypher that it was people who didn't want to fuck with me because they felt like, oh, well, you doing this and I was doing something similar, so we can't stand in the same room. Bitch, we supposed to be doing it together so we can get, we can boost it and we can go crazy. We can go stupid. Yeah. But people be so worried
collab, build more, build bigger. Yeah. For sure. I know that. I know
people
that
people worry about you coming in and just, you have I've been told before, you got strong personality and
hell yeah.
We don't want you to come in. Like, half the time I'm looking stuck and straight facing, bitch. I'm thinking, I got shit to do.
For sure. get it. That's because
people find that intimidating.
That's because that's where your focus is at. Mm-hmm. That's where your focus is. So, like, at the end of the day, people just got to stay focused to what it is, because if you focus on all that other shit, that's exactly what you're going to get.
Right.
Bullshit. Mm-hmm. It's usually bullshit. That's why I stay so focused on the content. And I really had to get you here, Gina. I really had to make sure that me and you had a conversation. I wanted to get to know you. I just wanted to hang out with you, really. I wanted you to come hang out with the homegirl Fox, for real. Thank you for being here.
No problem.
Thank you for putting out your motivation, putting out your realness, being yourself. We're all rooting for you, for real. Like, I know my audience is the realest. They know me because they know I'm gonna keep it real. Like, they know I can't fake shit. But that's the audience I fuck with. It ain't your friends. It ain't your, you know what I mean? It's another crowd out there who's there for you. But I know they're gonna fuck with you now. For real.
Hey, y'all.
There you go. You got a bunch of Latinas all up in your mix now. They're going to be rooting for you. Norbert's really happy. My producer's really happy right now. He likes Gina. He's like, she's tech savvy. She's funny. Look at him. He loves it. Do we got anybody to rate today? For a little while, because you know we're going to do something after this. Nah, no, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. We could do that. But real quick before I go, Gina, do you want to let them know where to catch you and all that? We'll have everything too, but for the podcast people to listen.
Yeah, you can follow me everywhere at Gina Views. Every link is in my bio for everything I do, the Cyphers, Ho Fashions, West Coast Confidential. Make sure you tap in. Yeah, I'm right there. Just, you know, rap commentators. Cypher curator.
Anything coming up? Anybody smart enough to make you host a concert again?
Yeah, we actually have a show coming November something. I don't want to say the wrong date. Just follow me. I'll keep y'all updated.
What about a part two? What about a part two of that other one that you said? You said you did one the Thanksgiving, between Thanksgiving and
Thankful for Hip Hop. Yeah, if somebody cut the check.
Yeah. That's what you put it out there.
If I get some you know, we might turn that next show into that. Thank you.
I got you, girl. I got you. I got you. Yeah. we create, but I'm all about giving shit like that. That's good. I got you, girl. You know what? Earlier when you said it, I was like, well, shit, that's coming up right now. Like, we're going to blink and it's going to be hip hop.
Actually, it's so crazy that you said that, because we were working on changing the title of the next show and I didn't even think about Thankful for Hip Hop, but I'm so happy you said that. So that's coming up. I'll post more about it by the time this drop. When you said a couple weeks?
Yeah.
We'll probably be filming for that show. So.
You gotta do it. It sounded dope when you said it. That's all. I was like, oh shit, it's already that time. Mm-hmm. So we'll be at Thankful for Hip Hop Part 2.
Yeah.
Volume 2.
Hey.
Yeah.
All right. Theater in Inglewood. I think it's November 6th.
Well, we'll see. Let's see who cuts the check. We'll set up your dates and all that. Are you talking about making that one the same one?
Yes.
Oh, shit.
It's already set up.
The only thing
is that what's not included, which I'm about to call them as soon as I leave here, is including the Christmas and Thanksgiving theme.
Well, you got to get on it, girl. That's next. All right, y'all. I'm going to leave you out like that. I appreciate everyone who was on Twitch, who checked in with us. I appreciate anyone who's following my girl now. Make sure you guys check out all her content. number one for me, I'm sorry, but Whole Professionals is it for life. It is just so good. But also the new show, make sure you guys tap in with these ladies, support the women.
Thank
you. just support them in general for doing the damn thing, because they do it really, really good.
Thank you.
I appreciate you coming, girl. Appreciate you. She's in Montebello, y'all. Gina View's in Montebello. Had to represent the hood one time. All right, guys, I'm gonna go ahead and let you go like this. We let bye.